and welcome back to another Future Doc House production.
I'm currently here on tour with QUPI.
We're at the Surgeons Hall Museum.
Let's go inside and talk to Chris Henry, the Director of Heritage, and find out what makes this museum so interesting.
How are you doing, Chris?
Very well, thank you.
Future Doc House.
I'm Jason.
Yeah. All right, so Chris, what do we have here?
Well, this is just one of our demonstration skeletons that we use for education purposes in this very room. We teach young children anatomy and parts and what the different parts of the body are. So this is just a model we use to do that.
All right. And what are the children's favourite questions you ask about this?
Well, I mean, it's very difficult to say. There are all sorts of questions about what's inside me and how does this work? And it all depends on the age range, really, because obviously the older you get, the more sophisticated the questions become. And people are, I think there's a kind of natural obsession with the human body, because we've all got one. So any kind of question you can think of, really.
All right, wonderful. Yeah. Well, as a medical student, we had to learn how to tell if the patient, the skeleton, is a male or female. So yeah. How do you know this one's a female or a male?
Well, you don't really. You have to tell me.
I can tell you. If you looked in the pubic area and if it was more V-shaped, it would be a male. If it's more U-shaped, it would be a female. All right. Very good. And I see that it says the Royal College of Surgeons of Edinburgh.
Yeah.
What's all that about?
Well, the Royal College of Surgeons of Edinburgh is one of the oldest medical institutions in Western Europe. Started as the incorporation of barber surgeons in 1505 and ratified by King James IV in 1506. So it is an institution that's sort of grown organically over 500 years to become a kind of standards organisation for surgery, as well as carrying out exams and all that sort of thing. And underneath that umbrella of organisation sits what's called Surgeons Hall Museums, which is what I work for as the Director of Heritage, which is the library and archive and the museum that you see outside of these walls. And the collections that are contained in. Okay. So it's a very, very old organization associated with medical training and practice.
Okay, yeah, because we're here actually visiting the Freshers' Fair, the Medical Freshers' Fair, mm-hmm. Hosted by the Royal Medical Society.
Yeah.
So is there a connection between Edinburgh University? And
there is. Okay. In fact, but Edinburgh University came after.
Okay.
in terms of the medical school is an 18th century production, if you like, whereas the college is much, much older than that. What you find is that there are lots of individuals, certainly in the 18th century, who were both instigators of the medical school, like Munro Primus, one of the first professors there, and who also were members of the college here.
Oh, wow. So there was the college started first in 1500s, then the university came in around the 18th century.
As a medical school, yeah.
As a medical school.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
So,
very interesting. Yeah. So do medical students still come in here?
Yeah, they do, yeah. Not so much. It used to be that if you went to the old pathology museum here, people took their exams in there. In fact,
wow.
You often see people coming in and they're sort of pale a little bit. They say, I did my anatomy exam in here or whatever. But these days, we still occasionally are asked to provide specimens, you know, to demonstrate a particular. I don't know where I'm from these days, but loads of medical students come in just to when they're in their first week in term. I think there's that sense of I'm in Edinburgh, I want to know something about the medical history, and where do you go? You come here because it is very representative of the, if you like, the medical diaspora that was created from the 18th century onwards, and for which Edinburgh is still famous today. You know, people go all over the world from here, having learned, been to medical school and then gone on to specialise, but they, you know, they still see this as where they initially started.
All right, so as a Director of Heritage, how did you end up in this position?
Oh, it's kind of a long story, really. I like you, had an interest in military history. I actually trained to be a weapons curator at the Tower of London. So that's where I started. And then I did all sorts of things, but I became the artillery curator for the Royal Armies. And I had quite a fit, and I went up through a sort of ranks, and I ended up being a director at other museums. And then I saw this at the time, that's interesting, it's quite a deviation away from what I do. And as a director or as a curator, which I was originally, you have to know a lot about a lot of different things. Sure. About how to do exhibitions, about how to look after objects and collections, about how to interest people coming in. So I'm not medical, but you need somebody that kind of has all of those skills to look after a place like this and engage people, but also make sure that the objects are cared for the next, you know, 200-250 years. So that's how I got into it. I think people have different ways of getting into it. And we've had surgeons, we've had doctors who've taken up the role as curator, and we still have people who come in and volunteer with us who are all medical trained, so there's, you know, it's a big mix of
folks. Even me, I mean, I studied medicine, but yeah. I was very interested in bayonets. Yeah. this period of history where it was less swords, more rifles, but they still didn't have enough bullets, enough gunpowder, so you still had to go back to the old way of fighting. So I can definitely appreciate that.
Well, if you go into the museum, you can see what the end results of that.
I studied it. One of the famous questions is, you know, a 20-year-old going to a bar fight, and knife wound here or here or here or here. Which organ did it penetrate, you know? Which nerve would be affected, because there's certain nerves that would, you know, be connected to that region of the body. So those are very famous questions that we have to learn and understand. Because I believe that in the A&E or the ER, we would be seeing these types of traumas, trauma wounds that would be coming in from bites, from you know, accidents even. So.
Well, yeah, I mean, advanced weapon is an advanced weapon, no matter how it's used, exactly. And what context.
A wound is a wound, right?
Exactly.
Whether it's from a bullet or from a knife.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay.
Well, Chris, thank you for your time.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.